is a look at the Wyze app for your robot vacuum. In this case, you could see I have it at the top of my list after adding, and I did change the name to Sally. So tapping on your RoboVac is going to bring up a map if you already have a map set up. In your case, you won't see anything until the first time you send your robot vacuum out. And what we're gonna do here is zoom in really quickly, because on the map, you actually see this little white circle that's moving around. That white circle is actually my robot vacuum downstairs vacuuming, because I wanted to set it up for, one, the purposes of this review, but also to vacuum. You can see these white lines are where the vacuum has been. For the most part, what it will do is a perimeter around your room and then go back and fill in the empty space. Now you'll notice down here, I have a secondary designation of room 2. This is one of the places where I think the software needs a little improvement. I, where the robot vacuum is, have a single floor. And this room over here is not actually a room, but rather a door outside. This is a long hallway that leads into a kitchen, and that is a door leading outside. It's all part of the hallway. But the mapping that the Wyze robot vacuum did designated this as room 2. And I cannot change the fact that that is room 2. Also, the brains behind the robot vacuum skip different rooms. So room 1, you can see it traced all the way around. And then when it's done with room 1, it will go back to room 2. But I just wanted to share that with you while my robot vacuum was going. It is really neat, because here you could see it went around the legs of a coffee table. And then over here, this is my dining room, which it can't make it under. And right there in the corner, that's actually my old robot vacuum, which I am leaving out for the time being, because it's the Wyze is now living under my entertainment center, where my robot vacuum normally lives. When you first start it, you will see down here, it will say clean. So you tap on that and it will start going. From here, you can pause, and then you can see it says continue or stop. If you stop it, it will head back and charge. In my case, I am going to select continue, and it's going to continue its cleaning cycle. You can see the area scanned right now is 323 square feet. The battery percentage is 70, and the time it has been running is 25 minutes. Now you'll notice that I have these red squares on there. Those red squares are the no-go areas for the vacuum. And this is one of the things I really like about it, because you can set up virtual perimeters that will prevent your robot vacuum from going into a particular location. In my case, I put everything up on tables and let it map my entire first floor. And then afterwards I tell it, don't go in the kitchen and don't go over here, because the kitchen is where my cat's food and water is, and I don't want it knocking into that. That is where my cat's bed is, and I don't feel like picking that up every time I want to run the vacuum. So all I have to do is move 2 TV trays into the kitchen, and then I can run the vacuum and not have to worry. It is odd the way that the LIDAR system works, because this little alcove over here is actually my stairs. This over here, I think it's my garage, but it shouldn't be able to penetrate the wall. It's an odd thing, and after the review, I'll probably remap everything. Coming back to our no-go zones, those are done through this little icon right here. Selecting this will allow you to add a new virtual wall or edit a pre-existing wall. And if we zoom in again, you can see there's a little trash can or a sizing arrow. You'll also notice that because I'm doing this while my robot vacuum is actually vacuuming, it pauses it until you're done. To add a virtual wall, you merely select add a wall, and then you can drag into place and then use the sizing handle to make it how you'd like. I do like the fact that you can pinch in to get that a little more precise as to where you want it. I do wish that they would have used lines instead of these square boxes, because I feel that you have a little more control with lines than you do these boxes. And we're just going to say, okay, if we made changes and we want it to save, or we're gonna hit cancel. I'm gonna hit cancel, and then right here, it's spinning, it says cleaning, and we will be able to watch this white dot here move in a second as soon as the app catches up with where it is. And there you can see it moving now. Coming to the upper right-hand corner, we have our settings for this particular device. First off, we have the name. We can change it. In my case, I called it Sally. As I said, my wife called it Sally. You can use one of the pre-selected ones, and then you just hit finish to lock in the name. Coming down is our scheduling. The scheduling is very good in that if you don't want to manually run this, you can come in here, select add a schedule or that big old plus sign, and you could select the times, the days, and then here's the fun thing, the actual suction level. So let's say you're setting this up for a Monday and you could set up multiple schedules. So I'm setting this up on a Monday. I'm not gonna run this when I'm home over the weekend. So I want the suction level to be really strong to get everything that I didn't vacuum over the weekend. You can do that. The other thing is you can actually select which room it will target. And this is why I said I wish their room feature was a little more robust than it actually is. I wish I could designate which room was which, because then I could go, this is my dining, this is my living room, and that's the hallway, and that's the kitchen, and then tell it, do the dining room, do the living room, do my hallway. Hopefully, in a firmware patch, that will happen. But that is scheduling. When you're done, you just hit save, or in our case, we're just gonna hit cancel because we're not actually scheduling anything right now. We're gonna select back one more time, which brings us to what we talked about when we were doing our scheduling, which is suction level. So you have quiet, standard, and strong. For me, I have found that my robot vacuum, based on the square footage of my first floor, I can leave it on strong all the time and still have 20% battery left. So I just leave it on strong all the time. It will, depending on the level you have it set for, change the noise volume. So if you want something running while you're around, you might want quiet. I have found that regardless of suction level, the clean that you get is very nice. Selecting back, we are going to show cleaning records. Now the cleaning records are very interesting in that it's a, you know, track of what you've done. So here you could see on the second, this is my cleaning record. I originally mapped everything and it took 1.1 hour. That's a nice thing about this. You can kind of shift that up and down depending on how big your square footage was. Second go around, you could see it took 51 minutes because I started blocking things off. You notice there is a share and a delete. So if you don't want a particular map, you can delete it, or we can select share. It will, in my case, tap into my Android share options. So what I want to come to is this one here. This was me attempting to do my second floor. So here, this is my first floor. And the way my house is it stacks the first floor on the second floor. I don't have this outcropping for my second floor. But I picked up the robot vacuum, put it on the second floor, and it did a good job. It mapped my second floor, but now I've got this weird extra floor mapping that I don't want. This is also where your room designations are. Notice it did not designate, because that's my master bedroom, a second bedroom, and a bedroom. It doesn't label those. And the other thing that I found, because I have the no-go zones on the first floor, it was picking them up for the second floor, so it actually got stuck on the landing for a while because it couldn't get past that no-go that I had set up for my kitchen downstairs until I removed it, and then it could travel around. And that's also where I said the mapping was a little weird. There was like a little bit under the table film on for YouTube. It left a wide swath just empty. It finished this bedroom and my master and then came back in here to finish. I thought that was a little odd, but again, it's a software tweak or a mapping tweak, I assume. So hopefully that can be changed in the future. But those are all your recorded sessions. So you can see I've been testing this quite thoroughly, and with two cats, I get a lot of opportunity to do so. You have your accessory lifespan. I'll flash up on screen what the original lifespan was for each of these items, but here you can see 295, 195, and then the 145. The HEPA filter is in a plastic case, as you saw in earlier portion of this, and I don't know how I feel about that, because obviously all of these parts you'll have to get from Wyze, but just cleaning the HEPA filter seems weird when it's encased in plastic. Reset map. So when I'm done, I can reset all the maps, meaning it will have to go out and make an initial map for itself again. And if Wyze doesn't come up with a way to have multi-floors, I think that's gonna be a little tricky. So they need to, in my opinion, have a setting for multi-floors and then have some sort of beacon or marker in a second floor or a third floor that you can put so that the vacuum can align itself to that. A new area that you might not have noticed before is the map editor. This is actually something that was added via a firmware upgrade and software update to the app after I filmed my original go through. So we're gonna add this so that you can see what the map editor does. So selecting the map editor brings up your map. You can see originally my robot vacuum designated one room and then two room over there, which is actually my hallway. If I select a room, I can split this room. So what we're gonna do now is I'm gonna say split, and then you get these little handles that are not the easiest to work with. As you can see, trying to drag them around, it wants to designate its own area, so it's a little tricky to work with. See right there, it wants to drag that all the way across, even though I want to say that's a room, it wants to drag it so that this entire thing is considered a room. So what we're gonna do now is I'm gonna say split, and we give it a second because it's gonna split that room. So now I have room 1, 2, and 3. I can rename the rooms if I want to. You can also, if I select room 3 and 2, you could merge that. So let's say you screwed something up and you wanna bring that together, you can actually do that. So what I'm gonna do is I'm actually gonna say yes, merge room 3 and 2, because that's really my hallway and my living room. Now that's one big room. Hypothetically, if I want to come up here and I want to split this, I can try to come here and here, if I can get that to go right there, come on. What I found right now is that it will not split this where it doesn't designate a wall. So all this around here is a wall. You need a wall to anchor this to, this point to. Hopefully, Wyze will fix that so that I can say from here to here, this is one room because that's my kitchen, this is my dining, this is my living room, and I'd love to be able to come up here and say, this is my hallway, I wanna do that. So if I split this, notice again, it's grabbing one of the far edges. So if I tried to actually take this handle here and bring it up over here, it won't do that. But the addition of a room editor is nice, so at least you can kind of make it do something. You can also rename the room if you want to, so living room, and select OK. And now instead of room 2, it's called living room. You can share your particular vacuum, again, with anybody who has a Wyze account. Device information. That's gonna give you a lot of device information. And then you have submit log. So network failure, hardware problem, or usage problem. And this will go to Wyze tech support. And you can delete this device. So there you go. Let's see how far my robot vacuum got while we were talking. Yep, so there you go. It finished my dining room and now is moving into the living room. I will say that it is nice that if you don't have a lot of stuff in the way, it will just and it goes through rather quickly. For the amount of square footage I have, which is roughly about 500 rounding up, it takes an hour to 50 minutes, which is really nice. Now that I have my robot vacuum back in its charging state, there are some things on this page that I don't particularly care for, and minus the bubbling around a new screen protector I'm testing out, the charging. Once it's fully charged at 100%, it still continues to say charging. So that's a little annoying. There's also no way to tell it do spot cleaning from the app. You can only tell it, I want to clean this room or this room. So I can't say do an outline, or in this case, that cutout right there is my cat's litter box. And I would love to be able to say, go around that litter box and pick up extra litter without telling it to go out and do the entire room. There's also no way to change or alter the voice commands, so they're always gonna be on saying things. And I know, in the future, Wyze may change that, but right now, this is a review of the app as it currently is. One of the other things that I wish the application had, because there's no remote with the robot, so everything is done through the app. There's no Amazon integration, there's no directional D-pad in the application itself. Hopefully, after seeing this review, they'll take some of the things that I said into consideration.